Hello everyone, my name is Philip and I'm an independent smart contract developer, so I'm mostly on the back end, so my slides are going to be pretty ugly, but hopefully the UX people and you can, you know, be tolerant. I'm happy there was some flames at the end of the last conversation, because this one is actually going to be extremely closely related. So. So I was supposed to actually present, Panache was supposed, from L4, was supposed to present in my place, but we discussed quite a bit, and he friendly proposed that I was present in his place. So thank you, Panache. Last, I think it was Wednesday or Thursday, Alex posted his slides on Twitter, and so I saw that by, you know, I was coincidence, and I was pretty shocked by how similar it was to my slide. It actually was a very, very similar concept. So I had to, me and Alex bumped into each other. We decided to, we put our two talks next to each other. He presented first. So I'm going to basically try to be complimentary for what he talks. So it's probably going to have some overlap, but hopefully you'll see that it's different enough. So so it's by Philippe and Panache. And what I'm going to talk about is, I'm not going to copy everything. So what Alex talked about is mostly key management and how do you have like a bunch of keys with different levels of clearance use a single fund in order to interact with the rest of the blockchain. And this specific contract that holds all your funds, this is a concept that I was personally calling smart contracts when I was talking to people about it. And I'll explain why a bit later. And this logic can also be, if people are familiar with account abstraction for EIP that might be implemented in sharding, that's actually a pretty similar. So everything that we do related to like improving the fund recovery, all these things could be implemented in, when we have account abstraction at a much lower level on a protocol. So Alex was presenting universal logins, and this identity contract in the middle is what I call personally a smart contract, because it can have a lot of logic that are not specifically smart account restricted to identity per se. And Alex was saying, okay, here there's a different level of clearance, there's recovery. And now what I'm going to basically propose is you can abstract it a little bit, and smart accounts can basically just be thought of like regular accounts that people are used to, where you can add in plugins that increase the or enhance the regular accounts experience. So for example, you have, this is the slide I was saying, it's pretty ugly. So you have the Bob Smart account in the middle, and you could have like functionalities where, you know, you have all these different keys that have different clearance level in the smart account. And then you could say, Bob could say, I want, you know, to have a way to have anti-theft protection. So I'm going to request every transaction I have, no matter what the key I'm using, even the highest level key clearance, I'm going to say, I'm going to request a two-factor authentication from, for example, MyCrypto. And if I want to disable this specific application or this specific plugin, I'm going to need 2 weeks in order to do that. So request. And I also want to have a crypto testament. So when I create my smart account, I'm going to say, here's all I want, what happens to my cryptocurrencies when I die. These tokens are going to go to this address. These tokens are going to go to this address. And then you can basically say, OK, my security providers or people that will attest that I died or have some sort of similar to the social recovery are going to be this. And the testament is at bobtestament.eth. And you know, like all these plugins could be existing solutions that are that people are working on, like Uport and all these things for fund recovery, same thing. You could also have like a plugin that every time you have any sort of transfer, automatically it passes through a mixer that hides where your fund goes. So you can basically think of all these cool logics, ENS, whatever, as extensions that you could apply to a smart account. So now I want to, Alex talked a bit about, you know, how you sign messages, and I think, with the people I've been talking to the last few days, it's not always obvious what we actually mean when we say everything becomes signatures instead of transactions. So I wanted to spend a bit more time on this. And also on gas relay abstraction, because this is, I think, is really, really interesting, and it's gonna lead to a lot of changes that will make the user experience much friendlier for everyone. So when you sign an action message, you're basically, Alex was describing, you could say, I want iBob authorize Alice to transfer 1.5 ETH on July whatever to anyone she wants, signed Bob. And this signature doesn't require any transaction, just a signed message that Bob signs, send it to Alice, and then Alice can take that, take that signed message, send it to the contract, and basically the contract will allow Alice to transfer 1.5 Ether wherever she wants, if these conditions are met. But now you could have much more complex types of signed messages that have actions. You could say, this is the action, this is a signature. You could have, okay, I, Bob, authorize Alice to transfer 1.5 Ether, July, if she provenly accomplishes X, and this is based on another contract, and then you can say, and before the 1.5 Ether is transferred, I want the Ether pass via anonymous mixer at secretmixer.h. So it goes through like 1,000 different accounts or like a whatever, like a ZK snark contract. And I also want out of these 1.5 Ether, 0.5 Ether that needs to be transferred to charity.ed. And then this is a single example, but you could basically abstract this and put any arbitrary action, any arbitrary logic, say, I want this to happen before someone can execute this transaction, and then this will ensue. And I think that's extremely powerful. So for an example, Bob, would do is say, okay, I'm sending this signed message that I showed previously, the first example. That's a different thing. That's a third-party transaction execution. And I think this is like really game-changing. So if I, Bob, want to transfer funds, but I don't want to pay for it for some reason, what I can do is I can say, okay, well, off-chain, I send a message saying someone transfers 2.5 Ether to Alice. Then there's a third party. It could be, as Alex was saying, a subscription model. Say, I pay you, $10 a month, and you will pay for 100 transactions a month, similar to SMS, right? SMS, you pay a certain amount per month, and you expect to have X number of transactions or messages per month. So you could pay a third party that would do that for you. So you sign a message saying transfer these, and then this third party that you could pay or whatever mechanism, it could be free as well, they send the transaction on chain with a signed message, and then that's going to transfer 2.5 Ether from Bob to Alice. And now you can have much more complex examples, and that's where I think we can take existing business model and apply very, very similar user experience. So when people go on Twitter, go on Facebook, they don't want to pay for every action. That's like a really bad user experience, and even like crypto hardcore people, like including myself, I could pay $2 for like allowing this website to remove the ads, but I still don't know. It's $2. I prefer having an ad blocker just because in my head it's like, why should I pay $2 if I can have an option that is free, right? And I think a lot of people will experience the same thing. Why would I pay for Facebook where if I need to pay versus like a good enough Facebook that, is free but has some disadvantages? And I don't think education could solve that for the global world. So what you can do instead is say, okay, well, you could have a Twitter, a decentralized Twitter that generates some profit, and that this decentralized Twitter pays for all the transactions of all the users. And that becomes like, you need to put some proper mechanism into place, but I think that makes it much more interesting. So you could have something says, okay, Bob, I want to store these tweets because it's a decentralized Twitter. I want to store tweets 256 to 512 on this Twitter contract. And the third party, which is the party that makes profit from you utilizing this network, says, okay, I'm going to pay for you, right? So Facebook generates a huge amount of money, but there's a cost for every user. You have like thousands of pictures, you have like messages. Facebook pays all these costs. These costs are hidden to the users, right? And the logic is very similar. The decentralized Facebook could say, well, there's a group of people that generate profit from this network being utilized or not. And the people that make the profit should take on the cost of the users. So the users could own this decentralized Facebook, and they could directly, just by sending messages, never having a single Ether in their account, still directly interact with the blockchain, because the people that generate the profit from having a lot of users on these decentralized application are paying the users' transactions. And I think that's really powerful. It's something that I'm working on with a project. And we basically want to make it so that any users that use our application never has to pay a single fee. And I think this is like really, really powerful. And this is very similar to what EOS is doing. And I wanted to, bring some other project inspiration in this discussion, because as much as like there's some points and like pitfalls and certain approaches, they also have, insights that I think are valuable. And with Steemit, with EOS, the logic is basically, we don't want users to pay, we want the people that provide the service to pay for the transactions. So in the way that Ethereum works in general, this is the logic, is how do you prevent people from spamming or just abusing the network if everything is free, right? Well, there's a simple solution. Every action has a price, and this price is calculated in gas. In EOS, it's different, right? So you're, if every application, be it a token, be it a smart contract, what the contract or application needs to do is you need to lock a portion of EOS tokens, right? So if I have like CryptoKitties, I would lock 1% of all these EOS in total supply, and my users don't pay, but anyone that uses the CryptoKitty application have a maximum, a CryptoKitty application has a maximum of 1% of all the resources that the network has. And this is pretty interesting because the users, you know, and now the users can play as much as they want for free on CryptoKitties. The only caveat is now that CryptoKitties need to make sure that they're not, their application is not DDoS. So they have 1% of the network. They cannot occupy the entire percent of the network. They can't take all the resources of the network, but the user could. You could have a malicious user that go on this EOS CryptoKitty version, and then that spams the EOS, and then occupies this 1% with a single computer, right? So the problem is reverse. In Ethereum, every contract has by default a DDoS protection, which is gas. In EOS, it's the opposite. In EOS, every application have to come up with their own DDoS protection so that none of their users occupies all the resources they have guaranteed. And basically, when we come back to this idea, what I was presenting earlier, if, okay, sure, it's free for, you know, your decentralized Twitter, decentralized Facebook, decentralized whatever game, anything you're thinking about, if you're paying for all your user transactions, you have to make sure that none of your users are spamming, right? But it's possible. We can basically go back to the regular business model, and how do you make sure that your users are not like destroying all your bandwidth on your application? And it's a very similar problem that we're having. So Ethereum, basically, each application can pay. There's a by default DDoS protection, and then if applications don't want to pass through this DDoS protection, they can implement their own DDoS protection so that their users can have a free experience. In EOS, it's the opposite. User have a default where it's free, but user applications are forced to implement a DDoS protection that is not gas. Or they could use gas as well. So what's next for smart account universal logins? I think this is extremely powerful if we can reach a consensus and standards. And you know, if every application like think along that most users will use something like this, and if most of the time when you create an account, this is something similar, I think that's going to really, really improve significantly the user experience for the whole network. And I mentioned earlier that account abstraction becomes interesting. And for those who don't know, account abstraction makes it that you can put arbitrary logic on your regular accounts, and everything that we do related to smart accounts, universal logins, could be used for when the account abstraction is ready. We can basically implement that at a much lower level and be much more efficient about it. So all the research we're doing now is also going to be useful for the next generation of Ethereum protocol. Reference, most of it is the slides by Alex and another one, the pictures. Thanks, Panache, Alex, and other people I talked to. A lot of good insights in the last few days.
Right, comments, questions?
I found that